So in the last lecture, we talked about how to calculate the moment of inertia for this continuous objects. Okay, so first case we did was this rod that was rotating about the center axis. Okay, through the center of mass, right? And it's a uniform rod. That means it has the same density throughout. Then we did the case for moment of inertia of the same rod but through the edge. So then we did for the case for a uniform circular disk, okay, and we found the relationship I is equal to mr square by 2, all right. And in all cases, what we are doing is we are trying to get the expression in terms of density rather than just the mass, okay, and then we integrate over the entire volume. So we looked at two theorems as well. So we did the parallel axis theorem. Where if an axis is parallel to the axis that is going through the center of mass and at a particular distance, then you know that you can just calculate I by just using this expression that is given. Okay. Similarly, we did the case for perpendicular axis theorem as well, where you need to know this value of the two axes so that you can calculate the value for moment of inertia of the third axis. Okay. And we did some examples. We did a lot actually. And finally, we ended up doing the case for a cylinder where we looked at the rotation of the cylinder through the center of the symmetry axis. Because along this axis, if you go in any direction, the same how the cylinder looks, right? So that's why it's called the axis of symmetry. All right. So if you move some 1 centimeter in this direction, or you move 1 centimeter in that direction, essentially the problem is the same. Okay. So and we again found the expression that I is mr square by 2, which is kind of interesting because it doesn't depend on the length of the cylinder. You see, so the length of the cylinder is not coming into picture when you rotate the object by this axis. Okay. The plan is that we will do the moment of inertia for the spherical shell and for the sphere today. Okay, so before we do that, let's so we have basically your cylinder is something like this. Okay, and we want to find if the cylinder is now rotating about an axis like this. Okay, that is perpendicular to the length. So this is the length we are defining this. And again, here, this is the value of your radius r. Okay, this cylinder has some total mass m, and we want to find that we have already looked at the case where the object is rotating about this axis. Okay, so let's call this x prime. Now we want to find the rotation along y. So I of y prime is what we have to calculate. Okay, so x prime is already known. It is m r square by 2.
So perpendicular axis theorem could be applied.
Perpendicular axis theorem can be applied. That's correct. Once we apply the perpendicular axis theorem, we will be able to, for example, find the value for this axis right here. Okay, so if I define this axis as a new axis, let's say this is E prime and this is F prime, and these two are perpendicular to the X prime axis, then I can find that I of E prime will be I of X prime divided by 2. Okay, remember we have to take the sum, right? So I x x prime plus I f f prime, right, is equal to I x x prime, and these two are the same, so I of e prime will be m r square by 4. Okay, so then you know this axis I e prime, which is parallel to the axis of I y prime. So now, once you have applied the perpendicular axis theorem, you can apply the parallel axis theorem. Okay, And according to this parallel axis theorem, your value for your I of y prime that you have to integrate, remember, you have to integrate this function to get your I of y prime. That's what we always do. Okay. And that will be just your sum of your integral of the value through the EE prime plus your value of the distance from here between these axes. Okay. And along this x axis, that is just some value of x square times dm that you have to integrate. Okay. Remember, it is from the parallel axis theorem, you have ml square. So m is what you're integrating. So you'll have dm, and l is the value of x, that is some distance x from this value. So you get an expression like this. Okay. And we already found that when you integrate this, you get this value. So the first term is just mr square by 4. Okay. And all you have to do is you have to calculate this next term, which is here. Okay. So this value is mr square by 4. Okay. So all you have to do is you have to calculate the second term. Okay. So again, the strategy has to be the same. We are integrating this x square, some small mass element. Okay. So if you take a slice that is going through this iyy prime, okay, this slice is essentially a disk. Okay. That's what it is. And when you integrate this disk over this entire volume, and then you get the entire volume of the cylinder. Okay. So note that this disk is similar to this surface element here, right? So the area for this is always pi r square. Okay. Area is fixed. Okay. What is changing? The change will be in the value of dx, right? So if I increase the width and I make the width all the way to L, then I will get the entire volume. So what I have to change is this dx term. Okay. And if dx, the width of this slice becomes L, then I get the total volume of the cylinder. Okay. And that's what I have here. So in the second term, what I need to do is I need to integrate, okay, about this axis. So I have to go from minus L by 2, which is the distance from the left hand side, minus L by 2 to plus L by 2. Okay. And my expression will be some x square times this dm term, which is rho dv. And I can just write rho times, and dv expression will be pi r square dx. Okay, so now I can solve these things out. So first expression remains the same, and for the second one, rho is a constant term, right? It is also given as mass by the volume. Okay, so I can just write mass by the total volume. Total volume is pi r square l. Okay, and I have a pi here. I can take that outside the integral as well. So let me do that. Pi comes out, and r, again, r is a constant term. R is the radius, so even r can come out. So let me do that. What is left is x square times dx. Okay, so that is the only term that is left. Okay, integral of x square dx from minus l by 2 to l by 2. Okay, so that would be some expression x cube by 3. And I have to now substitute the value of L by 2 minus L by 2 to L by 2 in this, for the limits in this expression. Okay. So I have 1 by 3 term that is constant. And the first term will be L cube by 8. Because I'm substituting L by 2 here in terms of x. And the second term will be minus of L by 2 the whole cube, right? So it will be again minus of L cube by 8. Okay, so minus and minus sign will become a plus, so I will get 2L cube by 8. All right, so I can simplify this expression further. First term stays this way it is, mr square by 4. In the second term, I can see that there are some cancellations. This pi will cancel, r square will cancel. Okay, I have an L cube here, so let me write that down. It will be 2L cube by 8 here. Okay, I have a 1 by 3 already outside from here. And what else is left? I have M and L. Okay, so M is here, L is here, that is left. Okay, rest pi r square and pi r square got cancelled. Okay, so then I get 2 can cancel, you will get 4. Okay, so and 4 3s are 12. So I would get M r square by 4 plus M L square, because 1 L will cancel here, divided by 12. Okay, so that is my value of my moment of inertia when the cylinder is rotating about the center through the length and perpendicular to its length. So you see now in our expression, the L is coming into picture, because when you rotate about this axis, it matters what is the length of the cylinder. Okay.
Along these lines, let's try to calculate the moment of inertia of a spherical shell now. Okay.
A spherical shell, you understand, is empty from inside. Okay, so it has some thickness, but essentially it's hollow. Okay, so if I consider a small mass element of certain thickness, like that is shown here, okay, then what I will get is, if you look at this small mass element from the front view, it will look like a ring. Okay, that's what it is, because inside it is a hollow. Okay, so this on the left hand side, you're seeing the same slice when you observe from this side of the spherical shell. Okay, so we have to remember that. Okay, so this step that we'll be doing will be a little bit new. Okay, so we have to find the moment of inertia of a spherical shell that is rotating about its diameter. So this is the diameter. All right, so it's doing some rotation, let's say it's rotating something like this. Okay, now what I have to do is, again, I have to define my axis. So I can define this axis as A or some A prime or something like that. And of course, I'm taking this slice, which is my small mass element, okay, which is what this thing is right here. So let me give some value like P, Q, so that you have some perspective of what's going on. So P is here, Q is here, okay? Now, if I look at the value that this slice has, so here, you know, for simplicity purpose, we have made this ring to appear very, very large, but essentially we are doing the case for a very thin spherical shell, okay? So this thickness is very, very thin. All right, and when this when we have a thin spherical shell, okay, so what we can do is we can use the angle approximation. Okay, so let's say the first value here is at a certain angle. Okay, and the second value here is at a certain angle, and this angle is what we are defining is as d theta. Okay, now this will be the radius of the shell, r, okay, and it has some mass. We have to define that as m, radius is r, okay, and this is the angle theta, okay, and this slice, whatever is the radius of the slice, this value r, let's call it small r, is the value that is right here. Okay, so this is the radius of the slice. So from here, you can get the relationships. This value here is your capital R, right? So if I take the sine of the angle, sine of theta will be opposite side, which is this value R, small r divided by capital R, okay? And again, here from the expression that we had used earlier, this arc length here will be given by this capital R times d theta, okay, because this value here is your capital R. Okay, so what is now the surface area that this ring is covering? Remember, we cannot talk in terms of three dimensional now, because it's hollow, right? So we cannot integrate the volume, because it's hollow, there is no material present inside this spherical shell. So you have to consider the surface area. Okay, so let's do that. So we have to consider this area of the ring. And then what are we doing? We are trying to create all these slices. See, we will create one slice here, this one here, one more slice, and we'll keep adding all the slices, and then you will get this entire spherical shell. That's the idea, right? So the area of the ring will be this entire circumference, right? We are talking about the surface area.
So the surface area of this ring element will be just the 2 pi r, which is the circumference, times whatever the thickness it has. Okay. And the thickness is given by capital R times d theta. Okay. That is just the arc length. Here you get that small r is r sine theta. And you can plug that in here and you will get that the surface area of the ring will be 2 pi r square sine theta d theta. Okay. So now what you're doing, you're integrating over the angle of theta when it goes from all the way from zero angle here to all the way to theta will increase to pi, okay? And that's what we are doing. So we will change the limits of the integration from 0 to m to 0 to pi, okay? So let's see what we get. We have for the shell, the volume is r square dm, and we have to integrate this. So instead of small r, we have this r sine theta. So you get r square sine square theta, okay? And instead of dm, you have again sigma, which is the surface density times the dA. So you have sigma, it can come out of the integral, and dA is this term 2 pi r square sine theta d theta. Okay. So essentially you get the value of I as sigma times 2 pi r raised to 4 sine cube theta d theta. Okay. So see, R, this capital R is constant for this spherical shell. So it can come out of this integration as well. So all you have to do is you have to calculate the integral of this sine cube theta term. Okay. And there is a very well-known trick to calculate these integrals of the sine and cosines that are to the odd powers. And the way we do that is we have to consider the sine, this sine square term as 1 minus cos square term, okay? And if we do that, then what you can do is you can do a substitution by choosing cos of theta as u, okay? So if we choose u as cos theta, then the du will be minus of sine theta d theta, okay? And you can split the sine cube theta as sine theta times your sine square theta, okay? So let me write that down, right? So sine cube theta is just sine theta times sine square theta, and sine square theta can be written as 1 minus cos square theta, and 1 minus cos square theta will just be 1 minus u square. So you get 1 minus u square here as one of the terms, and the other term sine theta d theta can be written as your du. So your integral here becomes 2 pi r raised to 4 times your u square minus 1 times du, okay? Because you have a negative sign, so you can take u square minus 1 instead of 1 minus u square, okay? However, you have to be careful. When you're changing the integral here in terms of du, then you have to change the limits as well, right? So when your theta is 0, your value of u will be cos of 0 will be 1, okay? And when theta is pi, your integral will change from of whatever this pi value to minus 1, because cos of pi is minus 1, okay? So your integration limits will become 1 to minus 1, all right? So let's see what we get. We have the surface area of a spherical shell is 4 pi capital R square. So you can plug that in the value of sigma here. So you have m by 4 pi r square, this term comes here, and your integral limits become 1 to minus 1. 2 pi stays the same, r raised to 4 remains the same. Instead of sine cube theta d theta, you have u square minus 1 du, okay? So now it is easy for us to solve the expression, because u square is just u cube by 3, and 1 du is just u. Okay, so you get u cube by 3 minus u, and here you can do some cancellation of terms. Okay, so when you cancel the terms 2 pi with 4 pi and r square with r raised to 4, you get m by 2 r square left. All right, so if you solve this expression by plugging in the limits, you will get that your value for I of the shell is 2 by 3 m r square. Okay, and that is your expression for moment of inertia of a spherical shell when it is rotating about its diameter, okay, or its center of mass. The last case that we want to do is the case of a solid sphere. Okay, and again, for the solid sphere, now we have to consider the entire density, which is mass over volume. Okay, so the strategy remains the same. Here, instead of using the angle, we are just going to do the hardcore integration with the limits of the radius. Okay, so this is the alternative method. I had mentioned before that there are four or five different ways you can actually solve this problem. So I am presenting to you two different ways to solve this shell and the sphere. Okay, and they are interchangeable. You can use the strategy for each other. So again, we are trying to consider a small mass element. It has some mass dm and it has some volume dv. Okay, now if again, the idea is the same. The reason why we are considering this small mass element is we can cut this entire sphere into sections like I have shown here. Okay, and as you add all these sections, basically you will get the entire volume of the sphere. Okay, now one thing you have to be careful is that this section that we are considering here, this section now is not a hoop. Okay, because it is a solid sphere, then you have essentially a ring like a disc. Okay, so it is a complete solid disc that you have as the section. Okay, and this section AB is your disc. Okay, and for the disc we have already calculated the value, and it is r square by 2 times the mass. So if this small mass element has a mass dm, then the moment of inertia of this disc section AB should be r square by 2 dm, right? And then we are going to integrate this mass and add all the mass, and then we should get the entire value of moment of inertia of the sphere. Okay, so again, we are starting from all the way from with respect to this center axis here. Okay, this point here. So we are going to integrate all the way from minus r to your plus r value. Okay, and so we are going to add all the mass from one end to the other, and we have to get an expression for this r square times dm. Okay, divided by 2. There's a factor of 1/2 here. Okay, so I've seen a lot of people miss this factor. So that's, you have to remember that this small mass element is of a disc. Okay, so now the volume of this small mass element will just be your value of pi times the radius of this small mass element times the width of this small mass element. So this radius of this small mass element, which is this small value r, okay, that extends from all the way from this top axis here till this bottom axis here, this value of r is just, if you use trigonometry, is just this r square minus this x square value of the length from this axis raised to 1/2. Okay, so that's just trigonometry. So what we are going to do is, instead of r square, we are going to take the square of this term and plug it into our integral. Okay, so we get an expression of your I as minus r to r. Instead of r square, you have this r square minus x square term. So that's where the term comes from. There is a factor of 1/2 here. So r square minus x square divided by 2. And instead of dm, now we have to plug in rho times dv. And rho is a constant, so we can just keep it as it is. And dv is this value of pi r square, which is the area of this disk. Again, you get pi small r square, I meant. So you get pi capital R square minus x square times dx. Okay, so that is the complete factor that you have to integrate. And notice here that we haven't used any angles at all. Okay, so we are just doing minus r to r. So this is your expression. You have r square minus x square raised to square divided by 2 times rho pi dx. Okay, and so you can take rho outside, it is a constant. So you get m divided by 4 by 3 pi r cube, which is the volume. So you can take 3 upstairs. So you get 3m by 4 pi r cube. You have a factor of pi that comes out of the integral. You have a factor of half that comes out. Okay. And you have your term r square minus x square raised to square. So you can just square those. So you get r raised to 4 plus x raised to 4 minus 2 times a times b, which is r square times x square. Okay. And you have to multiply dx, and now you have to take the integral. So again, you have to be careful. This capital R is constant. So for the first expression, you will get r4, and it's just integral of dx. So you get r4 times x. For the second term, you will get x raised to 5 by 5. Again, we are doing integral of x raised to n is x raised to n plus n, x plus n plus 1 divided by n plus 1. That is what you have, your expression here. Okay. And for the last term, you have minus 2r square, which is constant, and then you have x square, so you get x cube by 3. Okay, so that's your big beast here. And in the constants that are outside, this pi and pi will cancel. Okay, and you get 3 divided by 8 m divided by r cube. Okay, so that's your expression right here. Okay, so again, the final step is to substitute the limits. So when you substitute the limits, for example, here, you get r raised to 4 times r is the first term you have to substitute minus of minus r, okay, which is this thing right here. So then it gets added up and it becomes 2r right here. Okay, so that's what you're seeing here. So every time you have an odd term, the minus sign stays and negative of negative becomes a positive and you get added up. Okay, so same similar thing happens here because you have an odd power here, x raised to 5. So you get 2 times r raised to 5 here instead of just 2r. And then you, here you will get 2 times r cube, okay, divided by 3. All right. And here then you can take r that is constant to all of these. Everything is in the factor of r raised to 5. It will come out. And you can cancel this r cube and this r raised to 5. So you are left with r square term. And you have 3 by 8 m already outside. And inside the integral, if you solve it and just take the LCM, you will get that the value comes out to be 2 divided by 5 m r square. Okay. And that is your value of moment of inertia of a solid sphere that is rotating about its center of mass through its diameter. Okay. So that's your value for your case of solid sphere.